Good evening. I'm William Cooper, and you're listening to the Hour of the Time. Before we get into our broadcast tonight, folks, I thought you would like to know that the Arizona Republic, the rag that publishes the big lie, has a toll-free 1-800 number. For those of you listeners who have been with this broadcast for a long, long time, and I know some of you as much as 2 3/4 years, you might want to call this number and tell them the truth about what you hear on this broadcast, about what we really stand for, and about who we really are. The number is 1-800-331-9282. That's 800-331-9282. One more time, and I'll try and repeat it once before the program ends. That's 800-331-9282. I know many of you would like to call, and some of you live so far away that the expenses are prohibitive. Now you can do it, folks, on their nickel. Tonight, as I promised, we have a gentleman whom I believe to be a great American, someone who probably loves this country as much or more than anyone on this whole continent, who probably has done more in the way of bringing disparate groups together to try to form a coalition in order to win the 96 election than anybody ever done in the history of the country. So, without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to get into our broadcast, and don't go away because you're going to want to hear what this gentleman has to say. He's a hard worker. He cares an awful lot. He's already put together 3 meetings in Kansas City of many of the third parties in this country, including the Constitution Party, and groups that represent large numbers of people. He's done something that I never thought was possible, in that he's somehow managed to get all of these groups to agree on a common goal. And in this last meeting, tears were brought to many eyes, I can assure you, with the realization that we are on the road to a great awakening and a great success.
The United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The pledge of allegiance to the flag and the pledge to the ideals of our forefathers.
men who fought and died in the building of this great nation. It's a pleasure to fulfill our duties and obligations as citizens of the United States and to uphold the principles of our Constitution. And last but not least, it's a pledge to maintain the four great freedoms cherished by all Americans. Freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom from want, and freedom from fear. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty.
Walter Meyer, welcome to the Hour of the Time.
Good to be here, Bill. Thanks for the opportunity.
Well, it's certainly been something that I've been wanting to do for a long time. You know, of course, that H.R. 666 passed in the House today and goes to the Senate, and that does away with the exclusionary rule and allows law enforcement officers to practice warrantless searches at will, just about, and confiscate whatever they want, which can be used against anybody in court now. What do you think about that, Walter?
Well, I think it's just one more sad day in the history of this nation, Bill, and I hope that it is one more impetus for people to say enough is enough, and let's go about doing what we have to do in order to regain control of this country and to put it back on its rightful foundation and regain our liberties and go about life.
Well, that's certainly something that most of the listeners to this broadcast would agree with. Walt, tell us something about your background and what you've been involved in for all this time. Who are you?
Well, Bill, I'm from Kansas. Grew up here as a kid on a farm and spent a lot of time on them anyway when I was young. Went out and did my thing in the world. Came back here when I was 45 years old with the thought of being able to buy 400 or 500 acres and help feed a hungry world and just relax, enjoy life, and feed the kids, and do a lot of fishing and hunting and that sort of thing. And I found that you couldn't make any money in agriculture. This was back in the early 80s, and I wondered why that was, and I started looking into it, and the first thing I found was a report from the Committee of Economic Development, and it said, quote, "Removing excess resources used in agricultural production is the farm problem," end of quote. And I knew that I had better crops than what the average people did in the county because I'd gone down to the county and taken a look at what they were doing. And still I was losing money and all my friends and farmers and neighbors around me were going broke. And so I started studying this whole thing very thoroughly. And I wondered who this Committee on Economic Development was. And it turned out to be a subcomponent, a group of the Council on Foreign Relations. And I didn't know who they were, so I started researching that, and I found that was a group of people who are essentially a financial industrial cartel and people who control all the media in this country and one thing and another. And they had set a goal for themselves, and again, I quote that it is to plan for and condition the United States to accept its role in a new world order. And so the deeper I dug into all of this, I tell people it's a bit like cleaning out the barn lot, the smellier things got. And having had a background in engineering and business and worked as a test engineer for a number of years, Bill, I'm well aware that you can't solve symptoms, you can only solve problems. So I said, well, gee, this being the case and this thing is so widespread, and I know that there's all kinds of organizations out there across this country of ours. Some are concerned about abortion. There are groups concerned about their right to keep and bear arms. There are groups concerned about immigration control and so on down the line. I said, you know, really all these people are a little like Don Quixote in the windmill. They're not attacking the most fundamental problem of all, and that is that this country has been very deliberately and very systematically mismanaged to the detriment of its people, and for the benefit of this financial industrial cartel. And if we're going to solve that problem, we can't do it by attacking its symptoms. We've got to go for the juggler and for the problem itself. So the question becomes, how do you do that? And I sat down and I laid out a plan years ago, which was really going to be part of a book that I someday would like to finish writing called Taming the Tentacle Tyrant, if you will. But when you look at it realistically, Bill, you only have four chances to solve this problem. You either get the people who are in office to honor their oaths, do what they said they would, and they can straighten it out, or you replace them with people who will. The third thing you can try to do is to get some relief through the court systems. And the fourth thing you can do is dip into the bullet box. Now, those are the only four choices that we all have. There's a lot of boxes we can use to try to do that with. And in addition to that bullet box, you certainly have the soapbox, which each and every one of us ought to be on every time we get the opportunity. You have the mailbox. You can try to send people information to educate them, motivate them, stimulate them, get them to function as a team, if you will, by acting as a catalyst and so on. You have the two jury boxes, both the grand and the petit jury. You have a ballot box, and then again you're back to the bullet box as the sixth box. So that's the tools that you have to work with to try to do something about this country of ours. And when you really look at that problem then, and you start to set a goal for yourself, and I'm a great one for goals, because if you don't know where you are and where you're trying to go, it gets pretty tough to lay out a plan to get there. But if you set a goal, and we have done that, and of course it was agreed to everyone at the December Coalition Conference when we first got together, all of these various and sundry groups of people in Kansas City, that goal being to return government to within the limits prescribed by the Constitution. Now, if you're going to do that, you have to decide what are the objectives that lie on the critical path to that goal. We have identified four of them, and when I say we, the committee or the Constitutionist Networking Center, of which I'm the executive director of, is, of course, chaired by your former governor there in Arizona, Evan Meekum. And the four objectives that we all feel lie on the critical path are that, number one, we must retain the Constitution in the first place. And there are many threats against it right now. There are 29 states on record as having called for a constitutional convention for the purpose of obtaining a balanced budget amendment. There are three additional states that had called for it and who have rescinded their call, which would take it up to 32. Ohio is in the presently trying to get it passed there in the state, which would take it to the 33, and there is only a need for a total of 34. And I say it would take it to 33, that's on the basis that the Supreme Court may rule that you can't back a state out of it once it has become involved in it. And that remains to be seen yet, whether that would hold true.
Don't they have a contingency, just in case that doesn't work? Aren't they calling for a Philadelphia 2, which may be a constitutional convention?
Philadelphia 2 was not a constitutional convention. It is an initiative wherein they were trying to get it on the ballot in those states that have the initiative process, and this is Senator Mike Gravel, former senator from Alaska, that is promoting that, to try to get it on so that we, the people, could have the opportunity to vote themselves in a world constitution to replace our existing constitution. The one that worries me most right now, Bill, and I tried to fax you some stuff earlier, by the way, and your fax must not be on, but that has to deal with the Conference of States that was proposed last fall by Governor Leavitt of Utah. There is now legislation in every state being promoted by the Council of State Governments and really being pushed hard, and I think there are now six states that have signed off on it already, to call convene a conference of the states later this year, presumably for the purpose of allowing the states to decide how to provide a better balance between the federal-state relationships. I think this thing has all the characteristics and earmarks of being a constitutional convention in the making. And I know that here in Kansas, the hearing will be held at 11 a.m. on February the 15th for the bill in Kansas that would send a formal delegation to this conference of states. And keep in mind that when our Constitution first came into being, it was because there were the states sent a delegation to a conference to review the Articles of Confederation. They came out of there with a Constitution instead of an updated set of Articles of Confederation. They named their own ratifying process, if you will, which a convention can do, and this one could do the same thing. And again, you need to keep in mind that 38 states can do anything they want to with our Constitution and the federal government, because it is the states who are the principals to this compact called the Constitution, which is in essence a contract between the states and the federal government, and the states created the federal government as an agent of theirs to carry out very specific and limited responsibilities on behalf of those states. So under the provisions of any contract, of course, it is the principal to it who holds the ultimate authority and responsibility for the proper interpretation and implementation of that document. And the states, should they desire, the state legislatures, could force the federal government to come back into compliance with the Constitution. However, both the people, or most of the people in Washington, have been so bought out and by this financial industrial cartel. And even at the state level, the legislatures really understand so little about what's going on in this country of ours and what it is they're doing and why they're doing it, because they have just become used to complying with the model, quote, model legislation that is sent to them through the Advisory Committee on Intergovernmental Relations. If you've ever looked at the state legislative program alone that is put out by that group, it's an 8.5-pound book that's about 4 inches thick that lays out all the model legislation that they want passed in order to clone every state, if you will, have them all operating under the same set of laws, and to essentially put us into a dictatorship in this country of ours where the states themselves have very little control over anything, all of the power and the direction emanating from the federal government. And really, it's not even the federal government. It is all of the many think tanks that are associated with the ACIR, such as the University of California, Santa Barbara, and Columbia University has one, and the Brookings Institute is another think tank, and so on down the line. And so as policy guidance comes in from the United Nations, and that's really the governing body today, and the think tanks that are behind the UN, if you will, on behalf of those who want to control the political and economic destiny of all peoples in the world, and that's why it was really set up, and that's where we're really headed for if we don't stop it, that policy comes in from the UN. It goes into an administrative clearinghouse, which is part of a thing called the Planning, Programming, Budgeting System of Administrative Management. And this clearinghouse, which used to be located at 1313 East 68th Street, Chicago, Illinois, I don't know, it moved.
Wait a minute, say that again. What's that address?
It used to be, I think they moved, Bill. It used to be at 1313 East 68th Street in Chicago, Illinois, and it was always referred to as Terrible 1313. But if I'm not mistaken, like I say, they've moved somewhere. But the administrative clearinghouse then looks at what organizations would be required to pass legislation in order to implement that policy that they want implemented. And they then circulate this thing through the ACIR, which prepares the model legislation that would be required, and they feed it into the system through the Council of State Governments, through the Governor's Conference itself, through the League of Cities and Municipalities, through the National Council of County Commissioners, if you will, so that everyone in every level of government gets the direction that they need, and they, of course, are expected to rubber stamp that into existence, and that's how they manage to clone every city, town, county, state, and the whole nation and to control it under this dictatorship that we have now come under.
Now, Walt, as a responsible host, I must ask you a question at this point. Aren't all these think tanks and agencies acting as what would be called a council of wise men, and isn't it in the best interest of everybody to ultimately come together in a world government and do away with wars forever and ensure the peace and freedom of everyone?
Bill, if I thought for a moment that those people were doing this for our benefit and that they were trying to do it so that we would indeed have a peaceful world rather than to operate it as a tyranny, I might even be inclined to agree with that sort of thing. But I think it's been well demonstrated, and if one will just study the history of the last 4,000 years, that isn't the intent at all. The intent is to have an elite ruling class for the whole world, and all of the rest of us will just be slaves to that system. And we will not have liberties. We will not have the right to worship the Lord of our choice. That they want a world religion right along with all of the rest of their one worldism, if you will. Those who can produce are going to have their production, and who are willing to produce, I might add, are going to continue to have their production stolen for them so that they can redistribute it under worldwide socialism, and that's what's happening to us now. Perhaps no better example of that than what Clinton did last week when he bypassed the Congress and went ahead and bailed out the banks and the investors who had speculated in the Mexican pesos. And he did this without, of course, any constitutional authority whatsoever. And while we're on that subject, Bill, can we talk about it just a little bit?
Certainly. This is your hour, Walt, and I've been looking forward to what you've got to say for a long time, so have at it.
I tried to fax you a document earlier this evening, like I say, and I don't think yours is on, but I'd like to read a letter to everyone out there, and for those that are interested in helping to prevent Conference of States, which I believe can readily be turned into a constitutional convention. I would like to have them send me a self-addressed stamped envelope if they can afford to slip a buck in so we can send, you know, about five or six items back to them. I'll do that too. But in any case, I wish they would get a hold of a copy of this particular letter so that they can get it to their own mayors, their city council representatives, township trustees, county commissioners, state representatives, governor, congressional delegation, and of course to the United States senators. And it is addressed to the state legislators, governors, and members of Congress. And I just signed this off today, Bill. It's something you've not had a chance to see. I said, as you know, President Clinton recently bypassed Congress and unilaterally bailed out speculators in the Mexican peso. It's self-evident that this act was unconstitutional, as our Constitution doesn't authorize presidents to redistribute our monies to other nations by way of foreign aid, bailouts, etc. Such acts by President Clinton and his predecessors generate a question. Where have they found the power to take such unconstitutional actions? If required to cite their authority, I suspect they would claim it's in the emergency powers provided presidents by Title 12, USC 95, paren B. The United States Senate's report, number 93-549, says, quote, "This vast range of powers, taken together, confer enough authority to rule the country without reference to normal constitutional processes," end of quote. And that report was put out by the Special Committee of the U.S. Senate on the Termination of Emergency Powers back in 1973. I go on to say that informed government watchers know that these emergency powers transformed the U.S. into a constitutional dictatorship. And after more than 60 years under emergency powers, few believe any president will ever terminate them. This belief is further substantiated by Public Law 313, dated 4-14-52, wherein the federal government admitted to the unconstitutionality of the United Nations Charter by saying, and I quote, "Whereas the existing state of war, and that state of war we the citizens were declared the government's enemy in this Title 12 U.S.C. 95B bill, whereas the existing state of war and the termination thereof would render certain statutory provisions inoperative, and whereas some of these statutory provisions are needed to ensure the capacity of the United States to support the United Nations, it is desirable to extend these statutory provisions. End of quote. In other words, Bill, the federal government is admitting that the only way that we can support the United Nations is under this emergency powers concept, which took us out from under the Constitution in 1933. And Judge Basil, a retired judge who is a member of the Constitutionalist Networking Center's executive committee, has prepared a lawsuit challenging the unconstitutionality of the United Nations Charter on four counts. And we are working to try to find a state attorney general that will file that lawsuit directly with the U.S. Supreme Court, which, of course, an attorney general can do, because for a state, the Supreme Court is the court of original jurisdiction. But to continue with the letter, Bill, I say that in November 1994, our Republican governors unanimously adopted the Williamsburg Resolve. In part, it states, "The founders of our," and I'm quoting again, "the founders of our republic did not pledge their lives, fortunes, and sacred honor to achieve independence from an oppressive monarchy, only to surrender their liberties to an all-powerful central government on these shores," end of quote. In it, they pledge to, and again I quote, to restore to the states and the people the prerogatives and freedoms guaranteed to them under the Constitution, end of quote. Also, Governor Leavitt of Utah has proposed a conference of the states as, quote, "an effort that will restore balance in the federal system," end of quote. For the Republican governor's pledge or Governor Leavitt's desire to become reality, the emergency powers must be terminated and the government returned within the limits prescribed by the Constitution, the goal of our Constitutionist Networking Center. This will restore the proper balance in the federal system, restore to the states and the people the prerogatives and freedoms guaranteed to them under the Constitution, and help calm the social unrest building in our nation. By having a formal delegation from each state, the Conference of States has the potential of becoming a constitutional convention, something those promoting the New World Order have long advocated and made known that its target will be our precious Constitution. CNC therefore suggests that states not send a formal delegation to the Conference of States, rescind any legislation they've passed to this effect, and that 38 or more of them or Congress act to terminate the emergency powers. This approach will reduce the risk of a con-con and satisfy the governor's desire and pledge. Anyone interested in more information on this subject can contact the undersigned at my number or Dr. Gene Schroeder at his number. I would like very much, Bill, to, again, get that into the hands of as many people as we can so that they can get it into the hands of their legislators. I think it's an excellent opportunity for us to educate an awful lot of people as to where Clinton gets his power and what these emergency powers are all about, and hopefully that this can be the vehicle that will help to stop the Conference of States from becoming a real reality.
Well, that's wonderful. If you'll send me a good, solid, hard copy in the mail, we'll send it out with our info packs for people to use. We've got to take a break now, Walt. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
Of a country road on the wind it comes to call, and it sings in the farms and the factory towns, and where you think there'd be no song at all. And the words are the words that our fathers heard, every whistle down the years, and the And the name of the song is the name of the tree, and it's music to our ears.
America, America, and the dream goes on. America, America, and the dream goes on.
Ladies and gentlemen, the hour of the time, as most of you well know, is brought to you by Swiss America Trading. The only people dealing in precious metals, according to our investigation, that I could ever allow to sponsor this broadcast. And we knew it had to be someone who could help you prepare for the hard times ahead. And if you've been studying without even listening to this broadcast, you know that we're teetering on the edge of a very high cliff. One false move, and everything could come tumbling down. We're based upon nothing, absolutely nothing. I urge you to call our sponsors at 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289 against any kind of sudden economic calamity. And folks, if you don't want to deal with Swiss America Trading, please listen to me. Deal with someone. Anyone that you wish, but do it. I don't want to see you. I don't want to see any of you lose anything in the next few months or years. So call now 1-800-289-2646. Tell them that you listened to the hour of the time. Tell them that William Cooper sent you and you'll get red carpet treatment. And folks, I believe so much in those people, and I care about them just as much as they care about this broadcast. And believe me, they suffered a lot for the controversy that this broadcast sometimes creates by merely telling the truth. Thank them for sponsoring the hour of the time. And remember, if there's any problem, call me. I'll get with Craig Smith, and we'll make it good by hook or crook, or they won't sponsor this broadcast anymore. But I can assure you, you'll never have to worry about that with Swiss America Trading. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now. You'll be glad that you did.
And the more we remember the way we began, the closer we get to the best we can be. Ever a time we forgot his word, all the troubles and the scars. If we leave through the tears in a sky full of hope and a flag that's filled with stars. America, America, and the dream goes on.
It has been the voice of Canada.
Well, Walt, we're back.
All right, then we're ready to continue. I'd like to get on a roll because there's a lot I'd like to tell people between now and the hour, Bill, if we can.
Go for it.
First of all, if you look at the objectives that must be overcome to reach that goal we set of returning government to within the limits prescribed by the Constitution, there are four. You must retain your Constitution, and I could talk for the next half hour on that, but I won't. The second thing we must do is to be sure that we get a majority of the military and civilian law enforcement people in this country to understand what is going on and get them on our side, because without it, you will never solve your problem. The third thing is that we must get the government back under the Constitution. That requires, in my estimation, three things. Number one, get out from under emergency powers. Number two, do away with the lawsuit, or at least reverse the lawsuit, Erie Railroad versus United States, in which the case the Supreme Court decided that the General Welfare Clause found in Article 1, Section 8's preamble was sufficient to allow the federal government or the Congress to rule the country without reference to the enumerated powers. The third one is the lawsuit, the Erie Railroad versus Tompkins, in which case the Supreme Court said in 1938 that we would no longer have Article 3 courts in this country, that is to say common law constitutionally committed courts, but rather the courts would convene under the Uniform Commercial Code. And we now have, of course, judges who sit with a fringe flag in their courtroom, which signifies that they are chancellors in equity, and that is a maritime flag, not an American flag. And that's what that gold fringe means for those who have always thought that it's an embellishment to the flag. So you've got to get out from under those three things to get back under the Constitution. And then last but not least, Bill, we've got to resurrect the American system of economic independence, which means doing away with such things as the Bretton Woods Agreement and the IMF and the World Bank and NAFTA and so on down the line. And it also means that we must go back to a constitutionally correct medium of exchange in this country and get out from under the Federal Reserve System, which is a privately owned banking institution that creates all of our money as a loan. And you're well aware we have letters from the Department of Treasury which tell us that the actual creation of money always involves the extension of credit by private commercial banks. That is to say, we deal with nothing but a debt, and all of them are notes, as you well know, as a medium of exchange. When the Treasury was then asked, well, where are we to get the money to pay the interest then on all that borrowed money, if that's true, they wrote back and said money to pay the interest on borrowed money comes from the same source the money comes from, i.e. you must borrow it also. So we're in a position of having to try to borrow our way to prosperity. We've amply demonstrated that it can't be done. We now owe in excess of $26 trillion of public and private debt, and we've got somewhere in the neighborhood of $4.3 to $4.7 trillion of actual liquidity with which to try to pay that debt. The only mathematical outcome of all this, and this was concurred in by our governor here in Kansas 2 years ago, Joan Finney, and by the president of our Senate, Bud Burke, is that the sooner or later the Federal Reserve System must eventually own all real wealth of its choice, hold a mortgage on the remainder, and a claim on all of our future production. And so that money issue, the emergency powers issue, and certainly the 16th Amendment, which was, according to Bill Benson and Red Beckman, never properly ratified and yet was adopted, and that allows them to have this big siphon to suck out the money that they pump in off of their printing presses so that they can control us through the grant programs they have, and that also allows them to steal our monies and distribute it worldwide, if you will. Those are the three keystones to this socialist arch that's been built over the ashes of the Constitution. And once those three are taken care of, the rest of the arch will pretty well crumble. But you're not going to get those taken care of, in our estimation, Bill, until such time that we regain control of the government. So when you look and you say, well, okay, how do we do that? Well, number one, we should all try to work with those legislators that are in office now, find out what they're really made of, where they're really coming from, and what they're willing to do to help get us out of the mess that we're in. And to do that, you have got to give them draft legislation that needs to go through. And because they certainly aren't smart enough, most of them, to be able to draft it themselves, unfortunately, and those that are probably part of the New World Order crowd. So if we're going to do it, we've got to give them timely guidance, if you will, and draft legislation. And we also need to give them some physical and financial support when we find a good one that's in office. To that end, we have, of course, prepared a group of ultimatum resolutions. They are contained in a data packet that we put out, Bill. The packet runs $12, and it's got an awful lot of information in, including the United Nations document on the universal rights. It's got the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights that was ratified in 1992 by the U.S. Senate, which stripped us of our right to keep and bear arms. That right is already gone. And that's why you see all this gun legislation coming down the pike, and a lot of our other rights were transformed into privileges. It's got the information in it on the conference of states and so on.
You know, something that most people don't understand is none of these resolutions passed by the United Nations specifically giving anyone any rights whatsoever have active clauses, and therefore are not in effect and have never been in effect. It's a shill game to make people believe that under the United Nations they would have the same protection of individual rights as we have under the Constitution and the Bill of Rights.
Well, absolutely we don't. As a matter of fact, they are like this Covenant on International on Civil and Political Rights. That was passed. It was one of four treaties that were submitted by Carter when he was president. And it was ratified by the Senate in 1992 and became effective the 1st of September 92. And it implements a part of the United Nations program on universal rights. And that's why we no longer have the right to keep and bear arms, because it was never included in the United Nations scheme of things, if you will. But if we're going to, the second thing we can do, Bill, after we try to find out those good incumbents and help them and give them the proper legislation, the next thing we have to do is to replace those who aren't so good. And that's where we need to rally around the minor political parties such as you and the Constitution Party or the U.S. Taxpayers Party or Don Larson and the United Independence Party and different ones that are a part of this coalition and who have agreed and signed off not only on the goal that I mentioned earlier, but also on the Kansas City Resolve, which I think was a tremendous step forward in this country, that by virtue of this number of minor political parties, as well as people like Senator Don Rogers of California and Charlie Duke of Colorado and different ones signing off on that resolve, it is a commitment to use nothing but the Constitution as the basis for the platforms in 1996 and to all coalesce together and become supportive of a single candidate on behalf of the entire coalition. And I was talking on a conference call yesterday morning with Bernauer out of Ohio and with Don Larson, and they said that they had been discussing this and felt that there was over 3 million people that are now involved in this coalition. And Bill, that's enough people to turn this country around if we can hold it together and work on and bring to fruition the schedule of activities that we have set up in these last three meetings. But if you're going to do that, the one thing you have to have is a qualifying questionnaire. You must know where candidates are coming from. That is another thing that is included in this whole packet of information, Bill. And, of course, we also have to give good candidates that are running against incumbents some financial and physical support to help them get elected as time goes on. But the most important part of turning this whole country around, Bill, in my estimation, are little teams of people that would be down at the precinct level in this country that are dedicated to one task, and that is taking America back. And we need just to call them tab teams, I think. We don't need to know who are on those teams. It doesn't matter what organizations they belong to, although I would hope that they would support one or more of the organizations that are part of this coalition that has come together and signed off on that Kansas City resolve, so that those organizations indeed stay in business and become and get the support that is necessary to keep them there and to be viable.
Now, I know who those are, but our listeners don't, and I've sort of relayed a lot of this to them as time has gone by, but could you name some of the organizations and parties that are involved?
Sure, I'd be happy to. So far as political parties are concerned, at the first meeting that we had members there from the Libertarian Party, the American Party, the Constitution Party, the Committee of 50 States, United We Stand America People, certainly CNC, and then just a number of individuals. Then after we did that first conference, Bill, the people from the Populist Party, U.S. Taxpayers, and United Independence parties came on board. I believe there are going to be two more political parties that are going to come on board this also. We have not yet begun to go out to try to reach all of the different organizations in this country, and there are, I don't know, anywhere from, I've heard numbers from 2,000 to 30,000 of them.
There's a lot.
There's a lot of them. But I think that most of them would be willing to adopt that goal also and sign on to the Kansas City Resolve. And hopefully that they will go out and tell their people that, hey, look, the most important thing you can do is to put together one of these tab teams and get it registered into a common database. Now, we don't want the names of all the people. That's not necessary, and it just clutters computers as far as I'm concerned. We just want to be able to network with those people. I don't even care if they use a post office drop box so that nobody's name has to be on it, as long as we can get the word to them on what needs to be done, just like this letter I read a little while ago that we right now need to be getting in the hands of every political elected official that there is.
Now, let's back up just a little bit, Walt, because one of the problems we ran into is how do the parties and individual groups participate in this without some umbrella organization to provide the needed support and channeling of funds and coordination and all of those things. And I think Nelson Bernauer came up with the answer to that. Would you like to talk a little bit about C.U.R.E.?
Sure. What we decided to do, and this was at the January conference in early January, was to create sort of an umbrella organization that everybody could get under and get behind. It will be an ad hoc committee in essence, and I'm working right now with the Federal Election Commission and have talked to them, Bill, and have information on the way out to me, and I'm asking for an advisory opinion, if you will, from them as to which way to go to set this thing up so we can begin taking in money and spending it. But the purpose of C.U.R.E., and that stands for a constitutionally unified republic for everyone, is to take us from where we are today through the convention that will be held in September to nominate the presidential candidate on behalf or for this entire coalition of people. And we feel that everyone in this country, Bill, that is truly concerned and committed to the Constitution is going to want to, or if they don't, they at least should want to, become a part of this activity. And everyone is going to have equal opportunity to become a delegate at that convention to help elect that constitutionally committed presidential candidate, if you will, the coalition candidate. And they're going to do that if they are part of these teams, because we're going to let each of the teams nominate someone that they would like to have there as a delegate, and then we will set it up so that one of every 5 or 10 or 50 teams, I'm not sure what the number will come out, it depends on how many of them are registered, but we will have a ratio of some type there where a delegate from every X number of teams will be chosen then as a delegate to go to this convention that will be held in September. Of course, we'd like to turn 100,000 people out to that convention. And I know that's a lot of people, Bill, but I know that there's a lot of concern in this nation, and I pray that we can do that and be able to handle it. But C.U.R.E. itself, then, is going to have a number of different functions. First of all, there has been a team, and you're a member of that team, as you know, along with your governor, former governor of Arizona, Evan Meekum, to select 5 or 6 different people who they believe, or who you all believe, would make good presidents and for this country of ours. Along with you on that team is Howard Phillips, who heads up the U.S. Taxpayers Party. Don Larson, who heads up the United Independence Party, which is primarily made up of parole people, or former parole people, I guess it might be, but people who are concerned and who really understand that they've got to get behind somebody who's willing to speak the truth and recognize the real issues that have to be recognized. And then, of course, Nelson Bernauer is on that group, Nelson having been the head of the United We Stand America, anti-GATT and NAFTA teams that went to Washington and tried very hard to prevent those bills from being passed.
Now, are you talking about Nelson, or are you talking about...
No, I'm talking about Ivanovich.
Nick Ivanovich, that's what I thought. You said Nelson Burnout.
Oh, did I?
Yeah.
Excuse me. No, it's Nick that is on that team with you.
Well, I can understand how you get confused. Nelson's been contributing an awful lot lately. Oh,
Nelson, of course, has been chosen as the executive director of C.U.R.E. And, again, the functions of C.U.R.E. then are going to be to set up a series of sub-state, state, and regional conferences during this summer to be able to showcase these presidential candidates, if you will, and those political parties and organizations that are a part of the coalition. You know, we would like to have a seminar, let's say, in Phoenix, Arizona, down in your neck of the woods somewhere, where each of these candidates would be given an opportunity to speak to the people that are there, but likewise, so would each of those of you that are chairman of a political party, so that you can tell people what it is that you offer that's special and why it is that they should vote for your candidates at the state level and the congressional level, for that matter. And that I would hope that all of the participating political parties will be strengthened as a result of this, and that people will then, after having heard you folks and had a chance to look at some of your wares that you can have on tables and this sort of thing at these seminars, would be able to attract their attention and make your own parties grow and be sure that you get them qualified in as many states as you can, though it is intended to ballot qualify the presidential candidate as an independent with the endorsement of all of these parties. And to qualify them as an independent, we are going to have to be very, very well organized in each state so that when the word goes out that it is now time to gather those petition signatures that are needed to ballot qualify them, there won't be any hesitancy and lost time and lost motion. And again, that is why it is so important that people go ahead and organize their tab teams, 8, 10, 12 people in them is all. If it gets to 15, split up and make two teams out of it and hope they grow some. But that means that we're in touch. We will be able to give them the guidance they need in each state and for the forms that they will need and one thing and another. So when they have to get these signatures, it's just a matter of going out and turning the crank and not having to go through a whole lot of planning and mismanagement, if you will, at that time. So, again, that's the most important thing that people can do is to form their team with their friends, their neighbors, whoever, and then get it registered into a database. Not them as individuals, all of them, but just a point of contact, and we'd certainly like to have a place where they can be reached by fax so that we've already got the communication center set up to be able to spit the faxes out all night long and to get the word down to people. They, of course, need to have their own fax and phone trees on a local level to downline information. And then once we know who those people are in every county, who the teams are, or the points of contacts for those teams, we'll run the database and give people a copy of it so that they can get in touch with one another at the local level and begin to network down there on county and state level issues and also, I think, on congressional district level so that they can make sure that in the future they're going to send someone to Congress that will truly represent them. So that's just a real brief overview, Bill, of what we're doing. If we had more time, and I see we're about out of it, I would like to go into an awful lot of the highlights of all of these conferences that we've held beginning back in December. Maybe we can save that for another night. But they've been most interesting. I just thank God that the people who have been participating in them have been as willing to dedicate themselves to this cause and to agree to disagree agreeably when they have to now and then, but to continue forging ahead with one goal in mind, and that is to return this government of ours to within that Constitution or the limits prescribed by it, that in order to do that, the Kansas City resolve, and we do ask that each of these tab teams not only agree with that goal, but that they also sign off on the Kansas City resolve. And it says a lot of things, but when it gets down to the resolved part of it, Bill, I'd like to hit that real quick, that the undersigned hereby commit themselves to cooperate with every individual and organization sharing our goal, and to help develop, promote, and support a plan whose purposes will include, one, the formation of a coalition composed of selected state and national parties who share our goal, will support our plan, and are willing to adopt the Constitution for the United States as their national platform, while recognize their freedom to pursue their platforms within the states and under the powers reserved to the states by the 10th Amendment to the Constitution. They will also agree to the selection of a presidential and vice presidential candidate who share our individual and organization's concerns and interests, and that they will certainly place their loyalty to that Constitution. That they will recognize no political principle other than that Constitution and pledge themselves to the great principles of public liberty and national safety, and that the rights of the people and of the states reestablished again, and a government again placed in a condition of justice, fraternity, and equality. So for those of listeners of yours who could handle that, again, I'd like to see them go ahead and put these teams together. Then on round two of this thing, and how much time do we have, Bill?
Well, we're out, actually.
Okay, well, sign her off. It's been great. I thank you for the opportunity. Maybe we can do it again some night and continue from where we're leaving off this evening.
Well, we will, and let's shoot for sometime next week. I'll get in touch with you.
Okay, Bill. Sounds real good. I thank you again. I wish Godspeed to your listeners out there, and pray that the good Lord direction protects each and every one of us as we go through these troubled times.
Thank you for Walt, and thank you for Walt. That's right, and thank you, Walt.
I'll see you then, Bill.
Good night.
Good night.
Folks, I want to remind you that the number for the Arizona Republic, the 800 number, is 800-331-9282. That's 800-331-9282. And remember, CURE. Constitutionally unified republic for everyone. That means Mormons. That means blacks. That means Catholics. That means Chinese. That means Buddhists. That means Christians. That means American Indians. That means everybody who considers themselves to be a real American. Remember, the Constitution and the Bill of Rights recognize that every individual has a right to be that individual and worship at the altar of his or her choice. And it prevents the government from restricting or interfering with those rights in any way whatsoever. We are losing that protection, and we are losing it quickly. Join us. Good night, and God bless each and every single one of you. And remember, our enemies would destroy us any way that they can.
Tomorrow all the things were gone, worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, but the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. An American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that life to me. And I'd gladly stand up next to you when they take her to today. But there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Tennessee, I'm free.